So, no sign of Karula, no more tracks of hers, but she did veer off this road that was running perpendicular to us and came down towards us, and then that was the last I saw of her. Very interestingly, Mvula, the big male, dominant male, who we did manage to see this morning, he walked... We might even be able to show you both their tracks together here. Let me jump out quickly. But what happened was, is that both Karula and Mvula walked up this road last night. We're not sure if they walked here at the same time. Mvula could have headed here before Karula or vice versa. Either way, at one point, now this should be really great. The front two tracks they were walking towards you are very small, and these belong to Karula. And if you look just back here, this is one of Mvula's tracks. So look at the size difference from that back pad to that back pad. I know it might be difficult, but I hope you can see. Andrew, how's it looking? Can you see the size difference?
It's not looking bad. You can see it vaguely, yeah.
So this is the male's track, and this is the female's track. Literally right next to one another. And we're not sure, like I say, whether they were walking here at the same time. It's possible that they did. But either way, he continued straight up that road, and she veered off to the right, to the east. At least one of them was found this morning, and we'll continue to look for her this afternoon. So this morning, after Brian and I left the hyena den site that became inactive, we headed off to another hyena den site just to double check what was going on there, to try and establish, like I said, we were chatting about this morning, what's going on with these hyena, who's in which clan, how old are the cubs, what's going on with the cubs in the clan. There's a little bit of unknown at the moment as to what exactly is up. So headed off to the other hyena den site. It certainly does look active. We saw tracks going in and out of that den site, and you can see it's been recently lived in. So there could well still be hyena there, but this morning when we arrived there, there were none to be seen. So we might pop in there a little bit later. That is the den site where in Dapandula, a slightly older hyena cub, probably around 5 or 6 months of age now, if I took a wild guess, or a calculated but wild guess. And it would be nice to see that hyena and how it's progressing, because the last time I saw it, which was when I arrived here, I think last week, Thursday, it was looking a little bit thin, and it'll be interesting to get an update on it. Seems like the Cape Buffalo have decided that Trias Dam is the place to be this afternoon. We might even just stop here. because if we move any further along, we're going to be looking back into the sunlight at them. There's one individual in the middle, Andrew, with a lot of oxpeckers on its back, standing up there. And interesting how they've all congregated on the... Maybe it's some kind of a conference that they need to have. Oh, there's a few more that Andrew spots. They're not all on the one. And it's typical behavior for these old bulls to relax at waterholes during the heat of the day at this time of the year. Prime suspects to find, you know, it was no surprise that they were here. They really enjoy spending time at both this dam and Twin Dams, which is not very far from here.
They sure do bring in the flies.
They do. Okay. No, Andrew. You got it! Okay, I thought I was going to task you with your next challenge, but you were quicker than I was. Did you get it drinking, skimming
slightly
along the water? Okay, well done. Well, that fork-tailed drongo was taking a drink there and was flying. Oh, here it goes again. Look at that, a combination of drinking and bathing, I believe. So it's wetting its feathers in order to clean them. But the last time it did it, it certainly was drawing its bottom beak through the water to drink. Let's see if it plops in one more time. There it goes. Wonderful. Have a look at the buffalo quickly there. Sorry, Andrew, chasing you from side to side, but those two bulls were getting a little bit worked up with one another, and you could just see a little bit of the dust blowing away. And let's see if they don't get a little bit worked up again. Oh, well done. Andrew is all over it this afternoon, folks. He zoomed out just in time to capture the drongo doing its thing, and here it goes again. Good stuff. Oh, now there's two drongos, just to make life even more interesting for Andrew. Hello, there's three. Incredible! Great work. There's just too much going on here. I don't know, I keep looking at the monitor, then looking at what's going on around me. I can't keep track of what to do, but Andrew certainly is. That buffalo there on the left, Andrew, looks like a good candidate now. Well, this guy's really going for it. He's certainly giving himself a thorough mud wallow and trying to cake himself in as much of this cool mud as possible, and that will obviously be soothing right now at the moment, but it will also create a protective layer or covering to prevent any new ticks or parasites bothering him. And for any ectoparasites that are unlucky enough to be on him, they'll be suffocated by the drying mud, which he'll then rub off in a few days' time. That's normally the case though, copy that. Well, looking at them now, they look quite docile and non-threatening. But don't be fooled by the current display we are witnessing, because they can certainly, or they are certainly, very dangerous animal to encounter, especially on foot. They don't tolerate nonsense from anyone, not even lion, when they're on the front foot. What I'd like to do is try and get us a little bit closer. See if we can get a better angle of them getting down and dirty at the local mud wallow. Whew. There are a lot of flies there. Look at all those flies. Oh, I've just got one or two buzzing around my head, and that's frustrating enough for me. Look at all the dried mud already caked on his horns from previous mud wallows. Well, Alex has just sent through from Final Control when he was here a few years ago on another project with WildEarth. One of the old Buffalo Bulls was named the Judge because they do command that respect when they stare you down like that. And Alex just mentioned that this could well be the second judge because he does certainly know how to deliver a stare and command some respect. You can imagine how frustrating it must be not having hands and fingers to scratch and leave any itches or bites or insects that are bothering you, especially when there's this many of them. And that's why they'll often rub themselves up against various bushes to try and leave those itches or scratch off any insects that are bothering them. And we have some juvenile red-billed oxpeckers with their parents just below, so you can see the two parents feeding together, and the one chick, as soon as the one adult started clambering up higher up the buffalo, the chick on the left on the top started shaking its wings, and that's begging behavior. So those two chicks are waiting for their parents to bring them food, and let's see if they hand over a tick, a blood-sucking parasite, to one of the chicks to feed on. Oh, one buffalo got a little bit worked up. Not sure why. You'll notice, I'm not sure if I did mention earlier, the juvenile oxpeckers lack the yellow eye and red and yellow beak. Well, it'll be interesting to see what age that starts to come through. Such unique birds and such important birds out here in the ecosystem. Without them, a lot of these herbivores would really lose a lot more condition, they would lose a lot of condition due to the amounts of parasites that cause trouble for them. It's also interesting how to be big is important in terms of safety, but sometimes it pays off to be small. For these oxpeckers, it's safe for them to play around on a buffalo, which for an animal like us, the human, it would be a death sentence. So, an interesting aspect to look at, I guess, that size doesn't always matter. Well, I always get a little bit concerned when we leave Brent off air for very long, because especially when he's teamed up with Brian, they could be up to no good. So I think it might be worth us cutting across to them and checking what they've been up to. I haven't heard any updates. I'm not sure what the latest is on Mvula, but I think Brent would have made it to Buffalo's Hook Dam by now, so should have some kind of an update to give you. And we'll just stand by for Alex to confirm that he does have a picture for Brent's. How's Brent's picture looking there, Alex? Look at the one with the face paint here, Andrew. Have you noticed the one on the right? Sorry, I didn't copy that, Alex.
It's a bit, you can't really walk too much around there. There's a lot of buffalo bulls, so it'll be quite careful where you walk. I just want to double check he hasn't crossed through over this road. And we're going to go back around to the other side of the dam. Maybe he's found some more shade elsewhere. I think I spotted a steenbokkie, a little female steenbok. Very, very pretty little antelope. And those big ears. Their main form of defense against predators is to keep dead still. Obviously that didn't work for the one who Karula found a couple of nights ago. Very pretty antelope. We're going to keep on trying to find Mvula for now. Just going to check very carefully on the road here for tracks. I'm quite hopeful he hasn't crossed this road. I think he's found a nice shady spot somewhere in that sort of island between the two sort of inlets that come into the dam. So there's another vehicle who's checking on the northern side of the dam at the moment. Just wanted to double check, because it was quite difficult. He walked through the same place where the tracks of that pride of lions from this morning walked. So literally there were just tracks all over the place, and those younger lions in that pride, their tracks are about the same size as the male leopards. So it was quite a difficult thing to try to figure out, but I'm pretty confident he's still around the dam quite close by. I mean, even if we don't succeed in finding him now, we're definitely not going to move too far from this area. maybe a squirrel or start alarming, or impala or nyala or something. There's two different drainage systems that flow into the Buffalo's Hook Dam. So we've checked the one drainage system, no luck there, so we're going to check the other drainage system. It's likely you'll like to lie in that area now. Nice cool damp sand, it is quite hot. Good afternoon, Tom and his son from the Netherlands. They would like to know, how long does a leopard live for in the wild? Well, Tom, it is very dependent. The females will normally live quite a lot longer than the males. The oldest leopard I know about in the Sabi Sands lived to 21 years old, and the oldest male to about 15. But a male leopard at about 15, 16 is really not in good shape. He's very, very tired, so to speak, and he's sort of been pushed out of the majority of his territories, and he's really, really hanging on to the peripheries and trying to avoid other male leopards. So I hope that helps, Tom. But yeah, in captivity, they haven't been known to live well over or to about 25 years, but in the wild with competition from other leopards, it's very seldom that they do live that long. Watch out for the thorns there, Bri. Good afternoon, Zia, in Miami. Welcome on drive with us this afternoon from Juma Private Game Reserve in the Sabi Sands, South Africa. And Zia would like to know whether there's any plant that can be used as a natural insect repellent. And as Zia, you must have really good timing, because as I came out of that drainage line right on the road next to me is a plant we can use. This is called a dwarf wild sage. It's very, very aromatic. It can be used by just rubbing. It can be also be used for ticks, as a repellent for ticks. Also, if you dry it and burn it on a fire, also as a mosquito repellent. There's quite a few different species that can be used as mosquito repellents. But as far as I know, this is one of the more effective. So it's a dwarf wild sage. You can also cook with it. It goes quite well with lamb. Thank you. strawberry coming. Can you relay a message to Scott for me? Could Scott please contact Aubrey on the radio and see if he had any luck? I can't relay him on my radio. Okay, so guys, we haven't had any luck. I'm still very confident he hasn't moved too far from here. So what I think is we're gonna sit on this dam wall and just listen for a little bit, just be quiet, see if maybe some other animals might give him away. And as you'll see shortly when Andrew pounds across.
Brian.
When Brian pans across, there's quite a good incentive not to walk around too far with all these buffalo bulls in the area. So we're just going to sit quietly for a little bit and hopefully something spots him and lets us know. Six buffalo bulls here at the moment, and there's one who's lost one of his horns or half his horn. Still got the majority of his boss there. Definitely looks like he's had a long, tough life. A raft of hippos. I must admit, the area around Bisselsuk Dam is fast becoming one of my favorite areas on Juma. I mean, since I've been here, there's always a couple of buffalo bulls around, some hippos, we've had some wonderful elephants drinking here, and we've had the Nkuhuma pride of lions very close to here, and then we've had Mvula this morning. So it's definitely been a good spot for me. Picture of the one-horned buffalo ruminating. The nice thing about just waiting around here for a bit is the possibility of the elephants coming down to drink as well. It's the right time of the day. They do drink throughout the day, but there seems to be a little bit more of a peak during the afternoon. Oh, and then we've got some. Okay guys, while we sit quietly and wait to hear if we can hear any alarm calls or anything that might signal where Mvula might be, we're going to cross across to Scott.
welcome back. And we've come across one of the less common residents of Juma, the warthog. And this is a male. You can tell that by looking at both the front end and the back end. If you're looking at the front end, it's difficult now, but as he raises his head, you'll see he's got two protrusions coming out of his cheek on his left-hand side, and the same on his right. So four protrusions on either cheek, whereas the females have only got two protrusions and considerably smaller than the males. There we go. Thank you, sir. That's exactly what we needed you to do. He doesn't have the biggest tusks, this boy, but he does have a big body. And maybe he's still a youngster. Yes, we're here. Also, notice while he chews, it's not only the tusks from the top jaw, but also two from the bottom jaw. Now, those two tusks on the bottom jaw are actually the more dangerous ones. And you'll notice they seem... Oh, well, you may have noticed that they're considerably sharper than the upper tusks. And that's because every time he chews, they occlude or rub against his upper tusks, thus sharpening them into razor blades. And they will use those razor blades to defend themselves when down in their burrows. That's why they reverse down into them. If those of you were watching Brent's drive a few days ago, we managed to find a... I was on camera, but we came across a warthog that had, was just waiting at the entrance to its burrow, and it had reversed back into that. And Brent did actually ask people why they reverse back into their burrow, and it's so that they can come out with those tusks to defend themselves if anything tries to get in and attack them. And I've even seen warthog chase leopard that have caught their piglets. So it's a tough little customer, the warthog, and those tusks are what seriously aid them in their defense of their youngsters and themselves. Anyway, now that the warthog's run off, we'll cut back to Brent and continue where he left off.
Welcome back, guys. We're still sitting waiting at the dam. The buffalo have started moving around a bit, moving into the water. And then, I don't know if anyone is with us, I think, was it yesterday afternoon? Or a couple of afternoons ago, I talked about terrapins feeding off buffalo. And this guy here, here's the jumping, right under his chin, there's a terrapin grabbing ticks. And they said they got very sharp, sharp beaks. There's the terrapin. So quite often they get more buffalo than tick. And the buffalo can get quite annoyed with it and can be quite amusing. So there he is, he's moving back down towards the back leg. He's just gone under the water for a second. But just watching the buffalo will know when the terrapin gets hold of something.
When the terrapin strikes.
Yeah. It's a ninja terrapin. There's another terrapin coming to the left. Good afternoon, Naomi, from South Africa. Naomi would like to know whether I've ever witnessed an elephant giving birth. Yes, Naomi, I've been very lucky. I've witnessed it on a few different occasions, and it is a very special experience. I think the first time I can remember watching an elephant give birth, I must have been about 10 or 11 years old, in northern Botswana, and it was amazing how the other members of the herd sort of didn't really form a wall, but they were around the female while she was giving birth, sort of adding an extra layer of protection, maybe comfort. And there was quite a lot of that low vocalization you get from elephants, that... we didn't go very close to it because at that time the elephants in that area were very not used to people. They probably didn't see people very often at all, so they could be quite aggressive. So we watched from quite a distance, probably about 150 meters. But it is a very, very, very... Very special experience. And then I've seen it a few times since then, and actually once in the Sabi Sands, finer with it in there than anywhere else. Sorry, go again, Alex.
Start and end your day on safari.
Good afternoon, Kathy from Tennessee. Welcome on Drive with us on a sunny Friday afternoon for us in Juma Private Game Reserve. Sorry, I'm just gigging at the buffalo who's got, I think at my last count, he's got about 3 or 4 terrapins that are attacking the ticks on him at the moment. Kathy would like to know whether there can be more than one raft of hippo in a medium to large waterhole. Yes, most definitely. Kathy, but in a dam or waterhole of this size, I would say this is a single raft. So there'll be multiple females with one big male. There will be some sort of juvenile males that haven't got old enough to sort of pose a potential breeding threat to the dominant male. But in larger waterholes and dams, it is very possible to have more than one group. As long as there's enough space for the males not to have to interact too closely, otherwise they will fight extensively. Oh, there we go, that was a good one. He jumped up, oh, sorry. Bonus. I find buffalo's pain from the terrapins highly amusing. And then others are heading off to the mud wallow.
Sorry, there was one scratching its head there.
Oh, no. Wood. Oh, looks like that's swapping out. Hello, RC from the Netherlands. Netherlands is wondering what the Latin name for dwarf wild sage is. It has skipped my brain. I'm going to actually write a little note in my book here that I will. Oh, I have to look it up. My tree and flower book, unfortunately, is really big, so it's quite difficult to take it on Game Drive, so when I get back home tonight, I can actually take a picture of the page and post it on Twitter or on Facebook. Having a nice mud wallow. Oh, Brian, just to the right, there's a guy having a good rub up against the bank after being in the mud. So, I'll put a reminder. I've written a reminder down, the RC, and I will send you through that page. I'll post it on Twitter or on Facebook or on both. Why not? It is not Lantana camara. Lantana camara is a species native to South America, and it's very invasive and causes quite a lot of problems in Southern Africa. It's a very bad invasive species. We've got rubbing buffaloes. Very peaceful setting. Still haven't heard any Marsha on Twitter saying it should be a salvia of some kind. I'm not 100% Marsha. I'm not gonna guess, and I'll happily go look it up when I get home. So the terrapin's won that battle. He's decided to get out of the water. I think I counted about six at one stage that were mauling him. Oh, the oxback has just arrived. Obviously got an itchy nose. Very still. Only birds I can hear, doves. Beater very high up above us somewhere. And we've got another buffalo who's come from the other side of the dam and right in front of us grazing. So if any of you have just tuned in, we're just sitting very quietly next to the Buffalo's Hook Dam, waiting to hear if we hear any alarm calls and from birds or animals that might possibly give away the position of Mvula. With all the buffalo bulls around, it's a little bit too dangerous to walk through those thickets. There's no good climbing trees that I can see. Go with the question, Alex. Good afternoon, Jessica. I just would like to know whether there are, if there are cheetah in this reserve or just lion and leopard. There are cheetah in this reserve. Just have a look to the right of that buffalo. I will get back to the question. There's a oxpecker sandbathing. One of the reasons that birds do this is to get rid of dust mites and other parasites, and the small little bits of sand and silica manage to sort of rub the parasites off them. Sorry, Jessica, back to your question. Yes, there are cheetah in this reserve, and they do pass through this property from time to time. The cheetah densities in this area are always going to be a little bit lower than other places due to the nature of the bush around here, and also because we have a high density of lions, hyenas, and leopards. There we are. Buffalo standoff at the moment. He really walks like an old man. Oh, you notice that oxpeck has gone right up into his left hand here, feeding on all the little ectoparasites and big ectoparasites. Come on, Mvula, show yourself. Or at least show yourself to something that makes a noise so we can try find you. Unfortunately, from here, we're just going to see a shaking bush. But I don't know if you noticed, there's quite often coloration on a buffalo's horns. And that's from when he scratches it against different types of trees. Now you can see how easy that bush hides a very big buffalo bull, and you can understand my hesitance to go crawl around in those bushes on the opposite side of the dam where we think Mvula might be. Okay guys, we're gonna stay here and hopefully we'll hear some alarm calls, or possibly Mvulo, as it gets a bit cooler, might come out for a drink. So we're going to hand you over to Scott to see what he's got. So enjoy.
Welcome back. And not much has changed here other than our location. We're at Twin Dams now, and I'm hoping to find a bird called a giant eagle owl. Now, Mark said he heard one calling in these trees around Twin Dams a few days ago. So there's a strong chance that in any of these big trees around us, they could be hiding, or it could be hiding. They often live in pairs, and they're beautiful big owls. That would be really wonderful to show you. So that's one of the major draw cards that's brought us here, along with the fact that there were tracks of Karula, a female leopard, heading in this general direction. So two different animals, one a mammal, one a bird, that we're hoping to find here. Let's see what these starlings are up to. It looks like they may be drinking at the edge of the waterhole. And I'm going to just reposition ever so slightly to get a better angle for Andrew. And hopefully they don't all duck off. There's a few left there, but the majority seem to be flying away. There's also a buffalo bull in the water here. Oh, well, there's one starling left. And they're just such beautiful birds, especially when the sunlight is glistening on them. Their feathers iridesce beautifully. This one at the moment, you can see a little bit of that iridescence. I think partly because it's a bit wet, it's not as bright as usual. But there's one up in the tree to our left, Andrew, that is glistening. If you go further to the left, that one there, before it was covered by a shadow, it was glistening beautifully. But let's give it a moment or two. These are Birchall starlings. Really pretty birds. And the one down at the water's edge again, Andrew, is a, looks like a greater blue-eared starling. A slightly smaller one. You can see its bright yellow eye. Go ahead with the question, Alex. Angela in Massachusetts, good afternoon and welcome on board. Angela's asking whether there's any wild horses that occur in Africa, and there certainly are. Zebra, Andrew, just try to follow that woodlands kingfisher, and it's coming back, I think, Andrew. Oh, well done. And well, the drongo, the same bird that was plopping into the water at Trias Dam, continues to do the same thing here. But back to Angela's questions regarding wild horses in Africa. They do occur. I know there's some populations of them in Namibia, but I guess throughout Africa, zebra and the various subspecies of zebra are part of the horse family or equine family. But in South Africa, we just get the Birchall zebra. Further north into East Africa, you get the plain zebra, the grevy zebra, which are just two to come that come to mind. And the bird life really is pumping here at the Juma waterhole. All of the birds coming in for a late afternoon cleansing. And as I did mention earlier, that could be attributed to the fact that there's not much other water around at the moment. So because the water sources are becoming more concentrated, so too is the game arriving at these waterholes. And here's some beautiful grey go-away birds nice and close to us, which should make for a great shot. And possibly they're also planning on heading down to the water for a drink or a bath. What have you seen down there? You can see how it leaned its head forward to have a closer look at something down on the ground. And this is the only go-away bird that you get in South Africa, but you get different types throughout Africa that vary quite a lot in coloration, but most of the go-away birds that used to be all termed lurries, together with another, oh, it just regurgitated something there. I'm not sure what that was, possibly a small stone that it would keep in its crop to help with digestion. But as I was saying, they used to be part of a family of birds called the lurries. But now they're in their own family called go-away birds. And the other more colourful lurries have now become tarakos. So even though they're very similar to the tarakos, they're typically more drab coloured, more greys and whites. Whereas the tarakos will all have a bright red pigment, often under in their wings when they fly. You can hear a Cape turtle dove calling behind us. A very typical call of Africa. Kathy, good afternoon. Kathy's asking if there's any other flying animals that we get around here, i.e. bats. And there certainly are. There are insect-eating bats that we see coming out at dusk. And there are so many insects out here to feed on. Oh, well spotted, Andrew. Now that is a beautiful bird called the crested barbet. And what a great shot. So yes, we do get bats out here, and hopefully we'll be able to show you some, but the window of opportunity for us to show you them is very small, because they come out just as it's getting dark. We actually used to have a lot living in our roofs, our thatch roofs, when we stayed in the Manuleti over December and January. So there we would see a lot in the evenings flying out of our roofs. Okay. Well, it seems like it's been a birds and buffalo day. Nothing wrong with that. After all the big cat action we've been having over the last few drives, it's great to spend some time with the other residents of Juma. And there are so many of all shapes and sizes. But it is great for us to be able to, when things are a little bit quieter with the predators, to be able to spend time with them. Now my plan is... Oh, there's a beautiful bird. You're going to have to bear with me just for one last bird. And it's out of sight now, but don't worry, we are going to find it. It's an incredibly beautiful bird. And this specimen itself seems to be an exceptional specimen. Where have you gone? There you are. Got him there, Andrew?
Yeah.
Oh, with this afternoon sunlight, you are in for a treat. Ta-da. There you go. This, folks, is a carmine bee eater, and I've only been able to share this beautiful bird with you a number of times, probably two or three. And you can see that beautiful pinky red coloration on it, along with that tail streamer. Well, as it flies off, don't blink, because you'll really see it showcase its beauty as it does fly. Luckily, Andrew's had so... Oh, that was impossible for him to do anything with, but we'll head off in that direction that it did fly to, because they often fly and land on set perches that they will hunt from. They're incredibly acrobatic birds in terms of their aerial capabilities. But often perch themselves on a dead branch where they can then hawk their prey from. Where did you go, carmine bee eater? Ah, there it is. Got him up there, Andrew. I keep saying him, it could be a female. These are an intra-African migrant, so they come from the Central and North Africa for our summer, and are sadly, therefore, not here for the whole year. And they arrive quite late relative to other migratory birds. There's a family of red-billed hornbills that have just joined the tree, all three of which look to be youngsters, so they, in all likelihood, all brothers and sisters. And I can tell that they're youngsters because they've got a very small beak. But like I say, these migratory birds, the carmine bee eaters, only arrived, if I remember correctly, it was kind of mid-December that they arrived, whereas a lot of the other migratory birds arrived before that. Interestingly enough, Brent said that he saw in all likelihood the same bird in the same area just a few days ago when I was out with him. And they do stick to their territories once they establish them in a certain area, even often using set hunting perches that I was speaking about earlier. Oh, well done, Andrew. Sorry, Craig, could you go again with that?
Ingwe and Kunzo heading down Ingus Pyle and Leonard towards Twin Dams Road.
Copy. Mvula did head down there, or his tracks did head down there this morning that I followed, unless they from between drives.
Copy, he's in Kwanza on top of vehicle tracks.
Okay, copy, great, thanks. Okay, well, Craig, one of the other guides, said he's just found some leopard tracks quite close to Juma Camp. And it's the same road that Mvula's tracks did head down. It's actually the same road that I started this morning's drive on, following his tracks down that road. So it could be another leopard that's heading down that same road, just at a different time. So that'll be worth possibly looking into later. But in the meantime, we're going to continue the search for the giant eagle owl. So we're going to drop down into this riverbed. And apologies if the signal does get a bit shaky.
Craig, what area would you like me to check? Yes. Everyone talking over each other on one channel. Okay, so someone has found the leopard tracks. And they seem to have cut out of that block. We must have missed them. So we're going to loop around and go give them a hand in that area. Okay, copy. Then I'll stay in this area. Copy, thanks, buddy. Such a wonderful afternoon. It's almost perfect temperature at the moment. They might land in the road again, and just keep watching. But it was a double-banded sandgrass, a fascinating bird species. I mean, oh, they've landed in the road again. I'm going to try sneak forward very quietly, like a sneaky puff adder. But as I was saying, they're a fascinating bird species. They often live very, very far from water. And they nest quite far from water. So when they have chicks, how to keep their chicks, how they keep their chicks hydrated is by actually going down and dipping their breast feathers into the water. They're on the right hand track, right? Is that one? Yeah, there it is. By dipping their breast feathers into the water and actually holding the water in their feathers, it looks like it might fly. We're just going to stop here for a second, maybe let it relax a little bit before we go any closer. So they dip their breast feathers into the water and collect the water, and then we'll fly back to the nest with that water for the chicks, stored safely within their breast feathers. The other very interesting thing about sand grasses in general, not so much here where we only have the single species, but in other parts of Africa, they have timeshare drinking. So in Botswana, the yellow-throated sand grasses drinks very early in the morning, around 5 a.m. while it's still dark. Then at about 10 or 11 a.m., the Burchill sand grass drink. And then in the evening, you get double-banded and Namaqua sandgrass drinking. And the double-banded, all those sandgrass species in the very arid areas can get flocks of, I've seen probably in a morning, 5,000 or 6,000 Burchills at a waterhole in the Kalahari. But it's quite interesting how they sort of have different times to drink. So Burchill's 3 to 5 hours after dawn, double banded at dusk, and yellow throated before dawn in the morning. And other species that occur in East Africa and West Africa are almost completely nocturnal, and they drink sort of midnight. Okay, she's just gone into that grass there. I'm going to go forward a little bit more. Maybe she'll come out if we're patient. Is it a male or female? I can't see yet. Because there is dimorphism between the two. They're very, very pretty birds. Let me have a quick look. Oh, I can't see the head, but I think, yes, it's a male. That one there. So the male has that sort of black and white bars across the bridge of his nose above the beak. And a sort of, what's the best word I'm trying to, an ochre breast. And then it's got a very distinct black and white band on his chest. Hopefully he turns and shows it. Yeah, that's definitely a male. Here we go. Come on, now turn around and show us how you get your name. So because they're so regular with their drinking times, at the waterholes in the arid areas, they're targeted by lots of different predators, and they've developed a very sophisticated flight pattern. So they come in really, really fast, because you've got a lot of the siptas, which are small and predatory birds like goshawks and sparrowhawks, that will wait around the waterholes and take the birds out of the air. And that isn't even the end of it. Once they're on the ground, I know for a fact in Botswana and Namibia, the African wildcats and serval have learned to specialize as they come down to drink, and they will hide right on the edge of the water and quite often will jump up and take the sandgrass out of the air. And there's even been records of jackals even catching sandgrass at waterholes, and crocodiles in certain areas. So they've It's the only time they're really vulnerable is when they come down to drink. There's amazing flight patterns as they come in. He's just not turning around to show us his nice chest with his very distinct double breast. Try edge a little bit closer. Oh, there goes the other two. Oh, there they go. Okay, well, if you want to have a look, let me just turn the car off again quickly. That's him there, number two. So what we could see on camera was that very distinct sort of...
Let's move back a bit.
Sorry. There we go. Whoop, there. Yeah. We could see that very distinct black and white stripes on his nose. We didn't unfortunately see that very distinct black and white breast band, which is where he gets his name from, or the whole species gets its name from. As you can see, the female next to him, not quite as pretty, but her camouflage probably works better. And that's probably good considering she has to lay eggs and look after the babies. Although both parents will bring water back to the nest. They got a very, very cool call. I think it's a very, very cool call. It almost sounds like a 90s, 80s computer, like bloop, 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 like a lot of beeps and whatnot. Good afternoon, Kathy. Welcome on Drive With Us this afternoon. Kathy would like to know a bit of about my experiences of seeing rhinos. And Kathy, well, unfortunately, obviously, with the current state of affairs with rhinos at the moment, we never allow, we don't show them live, and that's for their safety. But we do see them from time to time while we're on Drive. And I've been very lucky in the past. I've had some amazing rhino sightings all over Southern Africa. And another one of my favorite things to do is track black rhino on foot, because they're quite exciting. But it is very sad. Oh, hang on a second. There in the open is another sand grouse. Let me just see if he turns around and shows us that nice double breast on his band. But there you can see very distinct that white and black on his nose. Sorry, Kathy, back to your question. ADD, easily sidetracked, especially by birds. But yeah, they're amazing animals. They look very prehistoric, even though on evolutionary terms they're not that prehistoric. They've probably been in their current form for about 200 to 300,000 years. Is he going to turn? There we go. Oh, we just got a glimpse of the double breast there. Quite easy targets from the poaching point of view. But I always enjoy seeing rhinos. Sand grouse are just not showing their breasts today. Terrible things. Off went the sand grouse, and we've got a question from Deborah in Arizona. Afternoon, Deborah, welcome on Drive With Us. She would like to know why it seems that the majority of the birds she sees in Africa have longer beaks than the ones that she sees in North America. Unfortunately, my North American birds are a bit sketchy, so I'm not sure what you're talking about, but Possibly because the bigger and easier birds to show you on a safari like this might be the water birds around the edge, and they've got developed beaks that are much longer for feeding in mud and silt and for catching fish and things like that. I'm trying to think, but no, if we started looking at your little seed eaters and cisticulas and other bird species, I think you would find their beaks to be very similar in size to the birds that eat the same thing in North America. So I think, I'm just guessing here, it's very difficult to know without have two species to compare. But so your little seed eaters, your fire finches and stuff, would be quite similar to the finches you get in North America. Sorry, I got a fly who's getting it. And then your waders, also your waders in America would have longer bills for feeding and foraging in water and mud. And then obviously the raptors would have those big developed hooked beaks for feeding on meat. So I think maybe it's just the birds we've showed you so far that have made you think that. But I think if we looked at sort of a species that are feeding on the similar thing like grass seeds and things like that, you would find that their beak sizes are relatively the same. I think we spent so much time around buffaloes today, the flies have thought I'm a buffalo. Scott coming. Alright, copy. Now, I've had the game drive radio turned down. They're very noisy this afternoon. I just want to know if there's been an update in the last 15, 20 while we've been with the sand loss. It's getting to that time of the afternoon, sort of magic time. I think we're going to have a really nice, sorry guys, one second. Sneaky leopard. Sneaky leopard. So I drove down this road this morning tracking lions, and on top of my tracks, I think I found Mvula's tracks. Unfortunately, that's very close to our boundary. I'm just gonna make sure 100% so I can let the other drives know who operate to the east of us that he has crossed. That's very disappointing. At least we got a really nice view of him this morning. I'll be back with you guys in a sec. I'm just gonna make sure 100% he hasn't. Maybe he's sleeping right here and we've got one last chance at possibly seeing him. And Konza Mvule Afambil. Yeah.
Pezul from our mover tracks this morning.
Yeah.
We've been running the mover on here today, so.
Andrew from
Chief.
Yeah.
This one is going.
100% Yingam fish. Yeah.
Okay, guys, we're back. Just with Aubrey and from Juma, and we just had a look. We found what looks to be the tracks of Mvula, and he's come out on Central Road towards Cheetah Cutline, and the tracks are now heading west. So we're going to keep following. We're going to let me just double check my map to check the best route, because update for Scott, we've actually got the tracks of Mvula on Central. They've come to Cheetah Cutline. They're now heading west on Cheetah Cutline. Sorry, they're heading south on Cheetah Cutline. So you must have snuck through in one of those hard patches of sand, or maybe walked past where I wasn't brave enough to go because of the buffalo. So we're just going to slowly go down here. So the tracks are heading down this road, and the other vehicles ahead of us following. They've got a tracker on the front, that's why I let them go in front. It's much easier for them to track with a guy sitting on the bonnet than it is for me to drive and track. So I'm quite happy to let them do some of the hard work for us today. And hopefully he stays within Juma. Scott coming. Yeah, FM, could you just update him on those tracks and ask him to update the GAM drive channel? I'll try update, but my radio isn't working too well. Copy, thanks very much. Come on, Mvula. It's the right time of day. You'd find him in that nice golden light. Oh dear. Judging by from where Aubrey's going, it looks like Mvula has decided to visit our southern neighbours. And you can see the sun getting lower in the sky. And I must admit, the temperature at the moment is close to perfect. Tracks go off to the south. I'm sorry, to the east. So we're gonna continue on and try find something else. Good afternoon, Marianne. Welcome on drive with us this afternoon. Marianne would like to know if I'm nervous walking around in the bush knowing Mvula's around. Sorry. Hi, Marianne. Marianne, I'm not nervous. I have respect. And fortunately, having been having been in the bush for many years, I've had the luxury to learn a lot of the behavior of the animals, and actually quite a lot of the time we track leopard and lion specifically, we track them on foot. So, and quite often you do come across the leopard on foot very close, and you learn you need to stand still. Leopard's quite a strange one, because when you find them in the bush, and you quite often they've seen you long before you've seen them, and they'll be watching you, and you can get up to sort of 5 meters from them, and then you'll suddenly just sort of see the rosettes in the bush off to the right. Because they rely on camouflage as their main sort of go-to technique for hunting and for hiding from other predators, you never, so once you've spotted a leopard, you don't sort of stare at the leopard, because then he sort of realizes he's been spotted and that could make him feel a little bit threatened. So if you do spot the leopard, you sort of just walk around, circle and go away, and then go back and fetch the car and then come in. Lions a little bit different. You always keep your eyes on the lions. And quite often if you get too close, they will give you a growl or a warning. Sometimes they might give you a sort of a warning charge or run out and just saying, you're too close, go away. And that's obviously during the day. You'd never walk around at night. We don't have, we're the dominant diurnal predator, and a lot of the animals have an instinctive response to that, so they don't actually want to fight with us. So they'll rather tell us, you're too close, go away, than actually get into a tussle with us. And that's from about 500,000 years, there's been bipedal diurnal predators in Africa that have been competing with lion and leopard and hyena and stuff for the resources here. So as long as you know what you're doing and you respect the animal and you don't take any unnecessary chances. And a lot of places people walk with rifles. I personally don't believe it's necessary, because quite often the only thing that happens with a rifle is you end up hurting yourself, shooting yourself in the foot when you get a fright, or hurting an animal. And if you've got enough time to shoot a charging leopard, he wasn't actually charging you, he was just telling you you're a bit too close and you should go away. But no. I don't feel nervous. It's actually one of my favorite things in the bush, is being able to track big cats on foot. So let's try and find another big cat somewhere else in the reserve. Just back to the rifle thing, I forgot to mention one last thing. If you're not comfortable walking in an area without a rifle, you should never walk there with a rifle. And a lot of the commercial lodges have the rifle as a legal requirement from the government. But there are other places in Africa where walking safaris are conducted with no rifles, like in the Okavango Delta in Botswana. And people who are not carrying a large caliber firearm are less likely to take a chance, so they generally will stay a little bit further away from animals, give that sort of respect the distance a bit more. Scott coming. Scott, did you copy that update about the tracks from Vula? Okay, copy. He was with me on the when I found them crossing. What area are you working at the moment? Okay, copy. I might make my way back towards Vuyatela and check from around there from those monkey alarm calls and waterbuck alarm calls from this morning. So the plan is, from now, guys, we're gonna make our way back towards Vuyatela or Gari Dam, where we had monkey alarming and waterbuck alarming this morning. And hopefully there is another leopard in that area, and it's the right time of the day, so we might hopefully find a male or female out on the road. Sorry, there's some tracks here. Oh dear. More leopard tracks, but this is a female now. This is so frustrating. All the leopard tracks this afternoon seem to be leaving our area. There's a lion from this morning. These are the lion tracks we're following this morning. See there. Oh, and off she goes. Wonder who that might be. Scott, could you update the Game Drive channels? Tracks of a female leopard cross into Torchwood from Mamba Road. Almost due west. Let's actually have a quick look at that. That's quite a stunning sight. You can see, can we zoom in a little?
Yeah.
And we can see the Drakensberg Mountains in the distance. So Drakensberg is it comes from the Dutch of Draken, dragon. So they were called the Dragon's Mountains by the first Dutch settlers in the area. And as I've said, it's always good to just stop and listen in an area. You never know, you might hear something that you won't hear over the engine noise, whether it be elephants feeding and breaking branches or animals alarm calling. Isn't that a beautiful sight? Very privileged to be able to live and work in an area like this. So guys, I'm going to put it up to you. Would you guys like to watch the sunset, or you want us to carry on, see what else we can find? Please send your answers to questions@wildearth.tv and on Twitter, #SafariLive. Crombeck there. It was a little crombeck. He's taken off and gone. Alex, come. Not to worry. And she's gone. Now it's predator time. go again. It's amazing, the bush seems to take on a different smell as it gets a bit cooler. I can almost smell that. I can smell the dust and certain of the grass species. Now I only need to smell out a leopard or a lion. We're making our way down towards the Moati drainage line. Oh, and from there we're gonna head north back up towards Gari Dam and see if we can find what everything was alarm calling at this morning. Gives you a bit of more about the engine there. Yeah, I did copy and I'm not quite sure what you're saying there. No, I understand that she's found it, but I can't make the Latin name up from what you're saying. Welcome back, guys. Sorry, we went through a little bit of a bad signal spot as we dropped into the Moati riverbed. Unfortunately, no tracks through there. We can't complain, we've had such
behavior. In other words, you can see them doing things the way they would have done them anyway.
Yes.
This is a very, very close view of these hyena. And I'm worried the adults may move off now. No, they're just lying down. Very close to the back of the vehicle. And I think we are going to hear them vocalize, which is going to be incredible from this close proximity. I've got such a big smile on my face. This is very, very special. And look at how cute this little cub is.
Oh.
Oh. Welcome back, and as you can see, the little cubs moved a little bit off from the vehicle. And he's just sniffing about now. I can see the mother, the one adult, she's just behind the vehicle. The other smaller adult, possibly a male, I can't see. Andrew, can you see the other one?
Just behind the vehicle as well.
Awesome. So just behind the vehicle. Now, as beautiful as the sighting is, and as much of a smile as I have on my face, there is some reality, what we can read into the situation, that isn't the best news. And let's see what happens now that the mother returns to the den, because if the smaller two cubs don't appear, that means we wouldn't have seen them out this morning. We just saw one poke its head out this morning very briefly. But if those others two don't come out, so I wonder what the story could be. Let's hope they both do pop out now. And I'm guessing the mother may vocalize, or even that smaller one, which could be a male, may vocalize at the base of the burrow and call out the smaller two cubs if they are still both in there. There's definitely one, but possibly one might be missing. Well, after having spent a few days, I think two or three days, oh, that's good news. There's one. Well, let's hope the second comes out and joins. Now, despite the genitalia that you can see that that little cub has, that doesn't necessarily mean that it's a male. Both males and females have very similar appendages. Oh, I can see the second and last cub just beginning to poke. It's hit out of the burrow. There it comes. Well, that's good news. I had a feeling that one of them might have been missing. And also great to see that the mother is giving equal attention now to the other youngster that has come out. And despite what you can see, it's hard to believe that we cannot tell whether that's male or female, that little cub. Certainly are cute animals when they are young, as most young animals are. There's not many animals that aren't cute when they're young. And the slightly bigger cub, possibly from a different litter, but not evidently being raised by one female. It's quite adventurous, and slowly each day we'll be expanding the area around the den site that it explores. See how wary the other cubs are. They've just snuck back into the burrow as the slightly bigger cub arrived. Then they come back out again. Let's see what happens between them. Be a lot of tension up to the point of death between hyena cubs. Because from birth they do compete very fiercely with one another. Well, I'm really happy that the adults have decided to stick around, because that means the cubs are feel safe and are going to continue. To play for us as long as the adults stay here, but there will come a point in time where adults will need to head out and start looking for their next meal, and wouldn't it be wonderful to be able to follow them for a whole night out and experience and encounter everything that they see. Holding her nose up into the wind, sniffing the air. I wonder what she can smell, because it's just got up off her feet immediately, and they've got incredibly strong senses of smell that they rely on to help track down and find carcasses either that have died naturally or that have been killed by other predators, and the hyena will then try and scavenge. But I hope you all notice that very drastic change in body language after she had lifted her nose up into the wind for a few seconds. Come on, they may vocalize now. You can hear gentle murmurings of them beginning a vocalization, and it would be incredible if they went ahead with one, because to hear it from this proximity would be quite something. Also to see the way they lower their heads. As they let off this call is really interesting. Speaking of animals calling, a happy memory came back from this morning listening to Mvula let off that rasping call of the leopard. That was something very special. Certainly paying a lot more attention to the bigger cub than the two smaller ones, it appears. And here come the adults. But at least one of them. Possibly it's time to head out. And the second is now joining. So that's it for the cubs, in all likelihood, until the morning. And the cub knows it. Well, interestingly enough, the two adults have laid down not too far behind the vehicle. So not quite ready, but as I say that, the one has continued off. And is it still going?
No, okay, it's still here behind me.
Not standing up.
Both lying down.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Thank you. Now you can see this. These cubs aren't as sure as they were before when the adults were around. And even from a young age, you can see that smaller cub trying to assert its dominance over the bigger one. And they're going to be reprimanded now and told to go to sleep. Possibly. Well, obviously, Mum doesn't want to leave her cub alone and just can't stop cleaning it. And now what could well be the father or the dominant male, who's notably smaller than the females, and that's normal in hyena society for the females to be larger and more dominant than the males. Very interesting how they've been to-ing and fro-ing, planning on leaving, coming back. They've done that twice. Now, will this be the time that they vocalize for us? It almost looks like they're getting ready to do it. Susan in Arkansas, good evening and welcome on board. Susan's asking if this is the den where, in Dapandula, a slightly larger cub was last seen, and it was looking a bit thin when we last saw it, and we haven't seen it since then, Susan. I went back to that same den site on the way back here this evening, and despite there being tracks heading up, hyena tracks heading in towards that den site in the morning, it was not active either this morning or this evening. That could just be bad timing. The den sites aren't always active every morning and every evening. Sometimes adults are too far away or waiting beneath the kill for a leopard to drop. Some tidbits. So it could well still be around, but we haven't seen it, Susan, and thanks for asking, and it's a useful update that everybody would like to know about, so thank you, Susan. Isn't this wonderful to see? I thought the show was over. Well, at least five members of this family are having a good time. The smallest of the two small cubs, as you can see, doesn't really back itself and doesn't spend too much time. I'm out the burrow. Very interesting how already from such a young age there can already be so much dominance and so much behavioral traits that you can read into the different cubs.
That was a blast! Mm. For us anyway!
Okay, they are very close to the boundary, as I said, so... Oh, no, here he comes. Just keep still till he's past us. Hello, little boy.
I hear you.
Nkomo Schnenfurt.
Oh, sorry, side lights. Too many light switches on this car. Okay, let's just turn around and switch off my side lights for now. Going to let one of the other vehicles, we had such a nice view and they are very close to our boundary, so I'm just going to let one of the other vehicles go ahead of us.
Thank you.
It's very important to share the sightings with everyone here. It makes for a really good working relationship with all of us. And we can help them find animals, and they can help us find animals. Okay guys, so we're all still busy following them. They are moving straight down the road, which makes it quite a difficult sighting for more than one vehicle. But we will stay with them, and when it opens up a little bit, we will try and jump around in front of them. Oh no, there's a big stump in that way. Can't go through there. Oh, looks like we've got some lazy lines. So here you go, you'll notice the young males lags behind. And these are quite often sitting while the rest of the pride are walking. Alex, once they get to the next boundary, I'll be able to tell you. If they cross into Buffalo's Hook, no point in extending. But if they carry on down into our property, then we will. Copy, thanks. So guys, I don't know if you heard my conversation with Alex and FC there. We will extend the drive if the lions stay in our traverse area, but if they cross, into Buffalo's Hook, but while we have them, we will extend while they are in our traverse area. So don't worry, we're not going anywhere just yet. Okay, we're going to try a loop in front of this lazy boy and see if we can catch up with the girls. Oh, isn't that a fantastic shot? Nice. That was beautiful. That was beautiful. See the size of those canines. Absolutely incredible. Copy, thanks. So it looks like they might have decided to lie down on the road up ahead. Just gonna see what Aubrey's doing. He's quite far behind us. We'll just jump in here. Wait, just listen. I don't know if you guys can hear that. There's a that young male's just doing some contact calls. He's quite a little bit far behind. So I've got some bad news, guys. This is our boundary, and there they go. So they're crossing, so unfortunately we can't stay with them, but it was a nice little end to the drive. I hope you guys enjoyed it. I certainly did. I always love seeing big cats. Very well in yourself. So I'm going to... The lines have disappeared. So the lions have left us, unfortunately. So I'm going to say good night. It was a pleasure having you with us this evening. We really do enjoy and appreciate all the questions you guys send in. And we look forward to hearing from you in the morning. I'm just going to cross you over to Scott so he can say his goodbyes. And as always, we'll see you in the morning.
Welcome back, and Andrew and I haven't moved. We're really enjoying watching this moon rise up to the east. And we're still at the hyena den sites. Interestingly enough, the adults are still here, the cubs are still out, but very close to the entrance of the hole. And the adults, I think, are going to be moving off shortly. And what I'm hoping will happen is that we'll then be able to follow them and see what happens as they continue their evening out and about.